This morning and every morning these days, Ferguson, Missouri is on edge. In fact, the whole St. Louis metropolitan area is on edge, awaiting news about whether Officer Darren Wilson will be indicted in the death of Michael Brown. Looking at the news accounts, it almost looks like preparations for a hurricane, with stores being boarded up and residents being urged to prepare at home with bottled water and plenty of food. Now, if a hurricane is our metaphor, members of the media are the ones standing on the beach waiting for the storm. And some residents do not want them there. Ferguson activists in particular feel that the media is out to get them, out to be against them. So they're making their own media instead. They're writing blog posts and they're posting live videos to the internet with their cell phones. These live streamers are sometimes competing with professional journalists, like CNN's own Sara Sidner. Sometimes what they do is impressive and it adds to the story, but other times it's openly hostile to the professional media. Look what happened here when tensions boiled over at one point.
Fake media is not allowed in Ferguson. Fake media gotta go. We holding y'all accountable.
Trust your media.
CNN told me that the protesters were violent and that they injured officers who were equipped with riot gear, and their weapon of choice was a water bottle.
And hey, y'all keep lying. We're going to come shut y'all down in Atlanta, too.
Even if I didn't work with Sara, I would say that's pretty scary stuff. It's disturbing to watch. Things are somewhat more peaceful there now, and Sarah's standing by to tell me about the tensions with protesters overall. But first, I want you to hear from one of them directly. In fact, the man you just saw there helping lead that protest against Sara, all while recording it on his phone. His name is Bassem Masri, and he joins me from Ferguson this morning. Bassem, thanks for being here.
Thank you for having me.
Tell me about that confrontation the night that Sara Sidner was shouted down by a group of protesters. What happened from your point of view?
Now, Sara, she's a great reporter. It was nothing personal against her, but, you know, it was against basically just the whole entity of the mainstream media. You know, we're not going for that no more. As a citizen journalist, we have a duty to let people know that there's a problem with stuff that, and we're going to address that from now on. You know, we're not going to be just laying back and let anybody paint whatever narrative they want when it comes to our community.
What is it that the mainstream media has been reporting and saying that you think is wrong?
Well, every time I hear a protest, I hear violent. I don't hear nothing else but that when it's been nothing but peaceful. We haven't hurt a cop. We haven't touched any of them. We haven't made it any aggression towards them. It's been vice versa. We haven't heard that part of it. We've just heard the narrative of the state's office and the police. But when it comes down to the street, you have to go online or on social media to get that.
Take me back to August, because before then you weren't even on Twitter, you weren't live streaming. Why did you decide to become a citizen journalist?
Well, because, you know, I'm a Palestinian. I know what the media can do. They can demonize a people for something, and me being from the both cultures. I was born and raised in St. Louis, in the Ferguson-Florissant area, along with North St. Louis, and I saw something on TV that I didn't see reflected on the streets. So, you know, I was, felt obligated to report what the people are thinking and saying, you know, because there's corporations, media, everybody has an agenda. You know, me, I don't have an agenda. I just want this to stop. You know, I've been victimized personally by police, so I know what they can do.
But I gotta ask you, what do you think the agenda of a media company like CNN's is?
To get news, to keep getting views, whatever that is, you know what I'm saying? To keep it relevant, to keep that entity relevant, you know, to make sure that everybody's got to rely on them for what's going on, or that they're reporting that, you know, for whoever, like most people, they, before a story's even ran, they have their mind made up. So it's really just appealing people for
what
they want.
But I get the sense that
the media empowers violence and empowers that stuff, you know? So it's, you know, when it comes down to it, if the Quick Trip didn't burn down, nobody would have been there.
Show me briefly how you do it. Is it just your cell phone? Is that all it is?
Yeah. This is all you need right here. You know, you just need your cell phone, the charger and a battery pack. You got your whatever app you like to use. There's a few of them, you know, Livestream, Ustream, Bambuser. You just download it, you connect it to your social media, and then you're just one button away from broadcasting live. That's gonna help you spread your message, you know, of course.
I agree with you on that, but I do wonder if sometimes you're trying to provoke. Let me play a soundbite from your live stream from one of the times where it did seem to get very tense.
What you doing here, bro? Out of here, man, with your coward ass boys.
That's the voice of Bassem Masri, who streamed this video live at the time.
Coward, straight pig out here, straight bitch. You gotta go. Your life is in danger, homie. You better go.
Another officer faced this.
Put your hand off your gun,
Citizens surround him and chant,
shoot, 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 shoot. I'm praying for your death. I'm praying for your death and your death and your death.
So that's from a local news package. Tell me about that. Aren't you trying to provoke the police there, trying to get more views maybe?
I'm just a citizen, you know? I'm a citizen journalist or whatever you want to call it. I didn't ask for none of this. When I put my live stream up, I did it to protect us. Whoever's watching is observing, you know what I'm saying? Don't mean any of the stuff that I said, and we're not trying to provoke violence. Nothing like that happened. If they actually were to go and watch that particular live stream, me, myself, I've stopped a couple things from happening. You know what I'm saying? I try to keep the people tense and to keep them focused on the police.
Fasim Masri, thanks so much for being here. I really appreciate hearing your perspective.
All right, thanks.
Bassam is not the only live streamer out at protests in Ferguson. Some nights there are 7 or 8 of them, and there may be more in the days to come. Let me bring in Sara Sidner now. She's also in Ferguson. What are the protesters' main complaints to you about the media coverage? Because you've been there now for at least a month, right?
Yeah, two, actually. And we hear a lot of things. A lot of times it's on social media with people haranguing us in any way they can.
Boy, the Twitter wars get really ugly, don't they?
Yeah, they do. I'm used to it, and I think most journalists who are here are used to it. One of the big complaints, there are a couple, but one of the big complaints is that whenever the mainstream media talks about these protests, they always bring up the violence. They talk about the riots. They talk about the tear gas. They talk about the looting on a wheel almost constantly. And over the past 90 or so days, there really hasn't been any of that. That happened a few times. And yes, we had to report that. Of course we did.
And of course
we're not going to not report something like that. But over the past 90 plus days, that has not been the case. Hmm. Have there been scuffles? Yes. Have people gotten arrested for standing in the street and refusing to leave? Yes. But they've also done plenty of days of peaceful protests where they are loud, but they are not violent. And that is one of the things. Another thing is something very specific. They complain that when the police put out, for example, a press release about what happened the night before, which they do daily, that sometimes the media will only report what the police say and not report what the protesters say.
Sara, given all the time you've spent in war zones in the past, are there similarities now in Ferguson?
Brian, I'm so glad you asked that. And I know some people I'll be criticized for this as well.
Yeah, it's an awkward thing to even ask.
Because it is awkward. It is awkward. But, you know, there are lots of similarities on the feeling here. And that is, you know, I covered the Israeli-Palestinian conflict. And for every word you said, you were condemned by one side or the other. And people would say, well, you're pro this or you're pro that. The same exact thing is happening here on a daily basis. People are listening to every single word we say. Anyone that is focusing in on Ferguson, whether it's folks who live here or folks who live outside of here who are looking at what's happening here. And so what you'll notice on Twitter is I'm getting some of the same, you're biased about this or you're biased about that, both sides saying the same thing, coming at journalists. Does it look the same? Are there AK-47s in the streets? No, but the feeling is very similar on how people see us covering this story, Brian.
Sara, thanks. Talk to you soon. You know, basically what we're seeing here is a democratization of media, the good, the bad, but also sometimes the ugly. And there are some similarities between that and my next story. Coming up, it's an outrageous one you probably haven't heard about. It's about one local TV station and why I think they should be embarrassed by their coverage of this picture. That's the Minneapolis mayor. I'll tell you why that's become controversial and try to untangle it right after this.